In a previous video, we demonstrated how nonlinear systems create harmonic distortion. For example, if we put a 500 Hz signal into a nonlinear system, we get an output that contains additional spectral content at multiples of 500, like 1000, 1500, and so on. In this video, we're going to demonstrate how nonlinear systems create intermodulation distortion, or IMD, and what some of the implications of IMD are. If you put a signal containing two pure sine tones into a nonlinear system, you will get an output that contains additional spectral content separated from the tones by the distance between the tones. These intermodulation products extend outward from the original spectrum, similar to how harmonics behave. To explain this phenomena, we're going to use a voltage amplifier example, similar to the one provided in my harmonics video. This graph depicts how input signals on the horizontal axis get mapped to output signals on the vertical axis. Notice that this graph is not linear, though a region in the middle might be very close to linear. Now, we can approximate this curve by a third-order Taylor series. As a note, this approximation is valid between the two critical points. So, if we let the input signal, x of t, be two pure sinusoidal tones, and the output signal be a third-order transformation of the input signal, you get this monstrosity. We can use trigonometric identities to understand the sine squared, sine cubed, and sine multiplied by sine functions. And if we apply the identities, we get this absolute mess. But let's try to pick out the frequencies. We see the frequencies of the original two-tone signal. We see the harmonic frequencies of each of the tones. And we see these additional sum and difference terms, which represent IMD. Now, these frequency components will be at different amplitudes. The amount of harmonic and intermodulation content depends on both the amplifier's characteristic curve and the amplitudes of the input. Put more simply, the distortion products will increase in magnitude the further you overdrive the amplifier. Now, in the audio world, this type of distortion is generally seen as undesirable and uncomfortable to listen to. However, some instruments, like the electric guitar, rely on this type of distortion to produce a characteristic sound. In the radio frequency world, a lot of this distortion can be filtered out with a bandpass filter. However, the intermodulation products nearest to the original frequencies are difficult to completely filter out, and often remain in some capacity. Now, remember how we used a third-order Taylor series? Well, a higher-order Taylor series may be required to accurately define an amplifier characteristic. A fifth-order Taylor series will produce two more products, and so on. Now, as we get further away from the original frequencies, these IMD products get easier to filter out. So, you will most commonly see IMD3 listed on datasheets for RF equipment. Now, let's go over some special considerations for the radio world. If you're using the two blue frequencies and they're closely spaced together, you might want to avoid using the IMD frequencies. Now, the particulars will depend on the modulation method and the application. For example, IMD can be a problem with analog wireless microphones.
All right, so let's actually show you the intermod distortion happening here. So we have our frequency one, which is 462.600. There you go. And we also have our frequency two, which is 462.700. There it is. And now when we take both of these and combine them, we'll see that we'll have our intermod distortion products happening up above and below the frequencies.
In a theater environment, you'll have actors moving around. If two actors were to get too close to the pickup antenna, they could swamp out a third actor's sound during the performance. This obviously gets even more complicated when 20 people have microphones on them. Software tools for frequency coordination from microphone manufacturers like Sennheiser exist. Now, what's being done about IMD? Well, technologies like automatic gain control can help, though there still is a point where a receiver will get overloaded. Newer digital transmission schemes are often intentionally designed to efficiently spread the use of frequencies across a channel. Since IMD3 scales with the cube of the amplitude at a particular frequency, using a wider, flatter channel greatly reduces the impact of IMD. For example, newer digital wireless microphones require much less careful frequency planning. Amplifier technology has also improved massively over the years to reduce IMD. For example, extremely linear amplifiers are required for cable TV and internet systems, as most of the channels are spaced apart by an even 6 MHz. Wi-Fi, cellular, and the latest cable modems use a technology called orthogonal frequency division multiplexing, or OFDM, which uses many closely spaced subcarrier frequencies. A very linear amplifier is required to keep these subcarriers from interfering with each other significantly. Furthermore, with modern two-way communication schemes, devices can intelligently adjust their power depending on how close they are to each other, reducing the chance that any amplifier gets overloaded. So, last thing we're going to do is a quick demonstration in Audacity, the free open source audio editing software, which is a great program for learning about signals. Now I'm going to generate a tone, and this is going to be a pure sine tone at 500 Hz. And we can listen to this tone. It sounds like a sine wave. And we can generate another sine tone at 550 Hz. Let's line that up. If we listen to the two together, it sounds somewhat uncomfortable, but this is what two sine tones sound like. I'm going to do Control A to select them both, go to Tracks, and Mix and Render. And if we look at the waveform here, we can see this sort of beat frequency. This is what you get when you combine two similar frequency tones. And let's go to look at the spectrogram of this signal. If we look at the spectrum, we see two frequency components, one at 500 Hz and one at 550 Hz, as we would expect. But if we select this track, we go to Effect and Distortion, we can create a distortion characteristic similar to the voltage amplifier we showed earlier. So let's do soft clipping and apply, and you see that all the intermodulation products and harmonics, specifically the 3rd, 5th, 7th, etc., are present. And the reason why it's only odd harmonics is because this was an odd transfer characteristic function. Now if we go ahead and play this, it sounds similar to the last one we heard, but even a bit nastier. So let's go back to the waveform, and we can see now that those edges were sort of smoothed off as we would expect from a soft clipper. So there, I think that's a pretty good demonstration of how amplifiers can cause intermodulation products and harmonics to occur in signals.